Lake Superior is not the first place you think of as a center for underwater maritime research. The ports of Duluth, Minnesota and Superior, Wisconsin close to shipping annually for winter. This is where Gerry was born and raised and went on to make significant contributions to the sport of diving and advanced our understanding of the maritime heritage of the state of Minnesota, Wisconsin, Michigan and the province of Ontario. In the 1960s, when Gerry started diving, it was very different from the way we dive today. We used double hose regulators and wetsuits. Buoyancy compensators and single hose regulators had not been invented yet. You had to do a lot more swimming in those days. The regional version of a diving mecca was Isle Royale. Most of the leaders in the Duluth area diving community had all made the trip. And the wreck that they all spoke about and regarded as one of their best dives was the SS America. The America was built in 1898 in Detroit and eventually was sold to the Booth Steamship Company in Duluth. There was also a Booth fishery, and the America carried passengers and package freight from town to town along the North Shore while picking up fresh fish. Highway construction resulted in the loss of business for the America, and in 1927, she struck a rock in Washington Harbor, and the captain ran her aground to save the passengers and to facilitate salvage of the vessel. But the ship was never recovered. Local fishermen salvaged what they could, but over the years, the ice and waves destroyed the pilot house and forward cabins, and the ship settled and slid down the slope into deeper water. The tip of the bow is just below the surface, and it is easy to find as it is marked as a navigation hazard. There is a community of Isle Royale divers that dock their boats and camp close to the shipwrecks. We went diving and camping and hung out together for years. It is also a great place to learn your way around a ship. You can examine the windlass, the pump, and the other features, and explore the entire wreck. We were also learning how to interpret shipwrecks. The hole that caused the loss is still visible. Shipwrecks are giant puzzles, and we observed damage and depositional patterns associated with the wreck event, and post-depositional damage caused by ice, waves, and divers. This is where we first met Gerry and his two principal diving partners, Bob Horton and Dr. Joseph Sneeways. Diving was changing. We were all diving new dry suits, and this allowed us to do longer and deeper dives. I purchased my first boat, and we were now also diving the George M. Cox, the Cumberland, and the Chisholm near Rock of Ages Lighthouse. It was in these early years that his unique style evolved. He was shooting 35mm slides and Super 8 movie film, innovative at that time. Gerry's approach was always a little different. In addition to his diving and camping equipment, he always traveled with his guitar he had played since childhood, a slide projector, a movie projector, and a Bible. He preferred dives of discovery rather than diving with the pack. One of his first films was shot on the America. It was Gorilla Diver, starring his brother diving the America while wearing a gorilla mask. Some people say that it's bad luck to rename a ship. The Puritan was renamed the George M. Cox after her new owner. They set out on a maiden voyage in the fog, and this resulted in the Cox in the Rocks, a local Isle Royale phenomenon. Gerry was out diving with his sister Marie on the wreck of the Chisholm when they made a significant discovery. They found the ship's rudder on the edge of a cliff in 70 to 90 feet of water. Gerry dropped down the cliff face and discovered the ship's engine, shaft, and propeller in 155 feet of water. Gerry kept quiet about this and over a number of trips photographed and filmed the site. This led to a formative moment at Windigo. Frederick Stonehouse is now the mayor of Marquette, Michigan. At that time, he had just written what he had hoped would be an authoritative text on Isle Royale shipwrecks. Fred gave his talk and Gerry spoke next and showed spectacular shipwreck footage of his new find. A star is born. That is where his focus was, to document shipwrecks in a pristine state. We were also diving the North End shipwrecks like the Monarch. In 1906, she ran into Blake Point in a snowstorm. Every year, we would start diving the shallowest shipwreck and then progressively dive deeper wrecks. The next deepest dive at the north end of the island is the Emperor. As a child, my dad and I would go fishing with a retired hard hat diver, Doc Fowler. He had a lot of stories, and when I was older, I was allowed to copy his photo album and his dive logs. Doc had done the first dives in the Emperor, right after she sank, and he declared it to be a total loss at that time. Gerry did a few dives in the Emperor, but was not particularly interested in that wreck. The Emperor's prop is 165 feet deep, and it is a challenging dive, but it is also the most popular dive at that end of the island, and that was enough to have Gerry looking at the wreck of the Condon. The Chester A. Condon was Lake Superior's first million-dollar shipwreck. She ran aground in 1918 on what became known as Condon Shoal. The ship broke in two. The bow is on the south side of the shoal in 90 to 120 feet of water. The stern section is on the north side of the shoal. This section slid down a slope and hit the bottom so hard the rudder was pushed up through the deck at 195 feet. We were diving there one day and Gerry tied his boat up off of mine to join us in the dive. He called me over once we were in the water to look at a scratch in the shoulder of his tank. It was more than 1/16th of an inch deep and I told him I would not fill the tank and to scrap it. 2 weeks later, we were all out diving and camping. I had just passed through Duncan Bay Narrows and was approaching the dock when the tank exploded. They had been playing frisbee and filling Jerry's double 90s on the boat. Bob went to check the tank pressure and noted that they were at 2800 psi and then ran to the end of the dock to catch the frisbee. And that's when the tank exploded. The engine still ran, but the hydraulics were out and the trim tabs did not work. The steering was gone, but by holding a steering cable in each hand, Gerry was able to navigate the 65 miles back to Grand Portage. There was $10,000 damage to the boat altogether. Gerry had some explaining to do when he returned to the park, but Ken had a sympathetic ear. Acting on a tip from commercial fisherman Milford Johnson, Ken Merriman and Ken Engelbrandt found the Kamloops in August of 1977. The Kamloops was launched in 1924 and went missing in December of 1927. She had been one of the lake's great ghost ships. The stern is 185 feet deep at the shallowest point, and Gerry began making dives and filming below 200 feet and entering the shipwreck. The Kamloops is lying on her starboard side, and her deck is 90 degrees to the bottom. Some of the crew are still at their stations in the engine room. Gerry was strangely absent from Isle Royale for over a month. We later learned that he and Ken Engelbert had got together and gone up to Rossport and made a dive in the Gwendolyn. The Gwendolyn is no lake freighter. The Gwendolyn was a luxury steam yacht owned by William Juan Harkness. It had a steel hull, teak decks, mahogany paneling in the interior. Harkness was a multi-millionaire He had the good fortune to be one of the original investors in Standard Oil with Rockefeller. They used the Gwendolyn in the same way a large company might use a corporate jet today. The owner declined the services of a local pilot. He thought his $11 fee excessive. The ship subsequently ran aground on McGarvey Shoal. The boat was grounded and the James Wayland, a powerful steam tug, was sent for. The Wayland's captain wanted to send for two barges to buoy up the stern when he pulled her off. Harkness told the captain of the Wayland she slid straight on the reef and she'll slide straight off, just pull. The ship, subsequently, sunk. The Gwendolyn was never a lost shipwreck. In the 1930s, Doc had tried to find her and made a few dives to the top of the reef, decided she was just too deep. A retired railroad worker, Ed Flatt, tried to raise her for a centennial project in 1967. He ripped off the top of the mast. Jack Coughlin was the first scuba diver to try to make the dive. He went out with Ed Flatt, made it down to 150 feet, experienced extreme narcosis, and aborted the dive. The first divers to actually reach the wreck were Chuck Zender and John Golden. They then published a sensational and highly speculative article, $3,500,000 to the diver who could reach the wreck of the Gwendolyn, in the Argosy, a treasure hunting magazine. Charles King Hegg, one of my diving instructors, and Fred Brunell tried to dive the wreck, and King did not survive the dive. Fred Brunell then vows to raise the Gwendolyn and founds a marine contracting business, Deep Diving Systems. Fred then purchased the CCR 1000 mixed gas rebreather. This rebreather had been a top secret U.S. government project put together by General Electric under a shell corporation, Biomarine. He then returned to the Gwendolyn with a barge, a crane, and a diving bell. Fred used a hot water suit, and he made two successful, shallower dives to the top of the mast. On his third dive, he toured the wreck. He removed the rebreather mouthpiece from his mouth to kiss the mast. This flooded the rebreather loop, and he had to swim for the bell to save his life. Ray Kenny also knew the wreck's location. He was contacted by Dave LeBlanc from Detroit, and Ray towed their small submarine out to the wreck. They found the lighting system on the submarine to be inadequate. They did not see much of the ship, and they jammed the submarine in a pinch point between the stern of the ship and the cliff face. They were stuck there for 45 minutes before tearing off a rubber bump rail and returning to the surface. They did not come back. This is when Gerry and Ken made their first dive. Unlike other divers before him, Gerry was bringing back 35mm color still photography and excellent Super 8 film. Based on his many years of deep diving experience at the park, Gerry built movie lights with two 500-watt floodlights from a 747. He then purchased a custom underwater camera housing with an ultra-wide-angle fisheye lens that accommodated a camera with a 400-foot film magazine. He could now shoot 13 minutes of film per dive. Gerry told the truth, but he always stopped in at Deep Diving Systems to show Fred his film when it was developed. I made a couple of dives, but felt that the ship was just too deep. Gerry was diving a lot with Joe Sneeweiss, who was shooting 35mm slides, and Bob Horton, who was also shooting Super 8 film. Gerry became a popular speaker and showed his movies at dive functions and other events. Fred's diving attracted the attention of the Ministry of Labor, and also investors, but he then had to acquire a recompression chamber, which he did. At about the same time, Peter Gimbel led an expedition to the Andrea Doria, and a television documentary was produced. This is where the public first had a look at the PP1 system. The Porpoise Pack 1 used a CCR 1000 rebreather, like Fred's. It was introduced as an electronic diving line, in common use in the offshore commercial diving industry. In fact, it had never been used in that application. The system also used a modified aquadyne band mask. The diver had the ability to switch from rebreather to umbilical and also had hardware communications with the surface. Most of the diving done in the Andrea Doria was done using band masks and bailout bottles. They did extensive in-water decompression and also recompressed in a chamber on the surface. The Andrea Doria expedition had a number of problems. A submarine and a diving bell did not work out, and Peter Gimbel had an in-water O2 convulsion. John Gerard was one of the principal biomarine engineers who developed the CCR 1000 and had his own company, Interspace. He then pulled his divers and equipment out of the project after Peter's O2 hit. Interspace Biomarine then merged with Deep Diving Systems, and the PP1 system had arrived in Thunder Bay. Fred then purchased a diving bell hull from the Krupp Steelworks in Germany and started building the Constructor, a maneuverable diving bell that had a number of manipulator arms that could operate tools, a camera, and a lighting system. It had a 3,000-foot depth capability and could lock out two divers to a depth of 1,500 feet. The Constructor was an expensive project and it took time to build. Gerry continued to dive and film, and Ryan joined the group, also shooting Super 8. Fred's investors were getting nervous, and Fred's lack of credibility was an issue. He returned to Rossport and put in a four-point mooring system over the Gwendolyn. One of his divers, Rick York, hammered a large rock bolt into a crack in the rock on the top of the reef as part of his mooring system. Rick also attempted to dive on the wreck in surface-applied equipment. He made it to 150 feet, experienced extreme narcosis, and aborted the dive. Gerry and Bob enjoy their notoriety and make a contract to explore the Gwendolyn from stem to stern. As development costs on the Constructor continued to rise, so did Fred's version of the value of the Gwendolyn and the amount of treasure that was on board. Fred believes in his method and is frustrated by Gerry constantly upstaging him. He then returned to the Gwendolyn with the pan and tilt camera system off of the Constructor. This was called the C-Scan. Using the mooring system he installed, they are able to maneuver the camera around the wreck. Unexpectedly, they find and recover the body of Charles Kenhag. Gerry hit the wall on the flying bridge of the Gwendolyn at 250 feet. Bob blacked out and Gerry had to give him a shake to wake him up to finish the dive due to extreme narcosis. They commonly experienced amnesia, and the only recollection they had of the dive was when the film was developed. While Fred returned to his research facility to continue development of the Constructor, Gerry returned to his basement, where he developed his own trimix tables. He used Beckman oxygen analyzers to mix his own trimix. Gerry then began a series of mixed gas dives and filmed the interior of the chart room. He filmed what appears to be a safe with the door wide open. Things became surreal in 1980 when the Calypso passed through the locks and entered the Great Lakes. They were making a documentary, St. Lawrence, Stairway to the Great Lakes. This was a difficult expedition for the Calypso. They lost a diver in the St. Lawrence, and then they knocked down a mast with the submarine while diving the Hamilton and Scourge. I was there when the Calypso arrived in Thunder Bay. Fred had expected that they would stop by, and he actually spent about $1,500 on bar and party supplies. Calypso's crew, whoever was in a somber mood. Fred's, as yet untested technology, had the potential of making Cousteau's technology obsolete. As an oversight, no invitation was extended to Calypso's crew, and they never met. Things went much better at Rossport. Gerry and Bob and company were all diving the Gwendolyn, and they met the Calypso at the dock. Jacques Cousteau was not on board, and Jean-Michel Cousteau was leading the expedition. They all got together and had a barbecue at Ray's. At first, they wanted to use the submarine to film Gerry diving. This did not happen, as it was a little too choppy for diving for Gerry. They did all head out to McGarvey Shoal and found Gerry's float. They used the submarine to follow the line down to the Gwendolyn and filmed the wreck for about 45 minutes. A couple of days later, there was a newspaper article noting Calypso's discovery of the Gwendolyn. When they finally completed construction of the constructor, they tested the submersible and the slip beside deep diving systems, and everything worked great. Fred then organized a huge party to christen the constructor. Members of Parliament and other dignitaries attended. Several made speeches. Christening a vessel is an ancient religious tradition that predates Christianity. It is similar to baptizing a child. The vessel is presented to the Lord, and a bottle of champagne is smashed against the hull. According to superstition, if the bottle does not break on the first try, the ship and all those who sail aboard her will be cursed with bad luck. Of course, Fred was not going to let some old wives' tale stand in the way of his project. They launched the constructor and toured the slip. Fred was seen as a success, and the crowd went wild. After a successful demonstration of his technology, Fred entertained. As he had a recompression chamber which could be used in a number of medical applications, there were doctors in attendance, and lawyers, and the Indian chief in the Fort William Band Council. Fred had a few of the girls from the Mariposa there to serve appetizers and drinks. There was some heavy drinking there that night. The next job was the constructor's sea trials. They loaded her onto the DDS salvager, Fred's huge barge, and headed out to Sawyer's Bay to put her through her paces. It was a serious test, as Fred had a $90,000 contract with the Navy on the line. They spent quite a bit of time demonstrating the capabilities of the constructor's manipulator arms. They did some underwater jetting with a high-pressure hose, they released floats, and they attached shackles to lifting points on targets. They also locked out two divers. They are wearing prototype camshell helmets. These hats were an open-circuit configuration, but they did have a plan to build a version that could be switched to a closed circuit for rebreather diving. Unfortunately, one of the hats developed a leak, but the diver made it back into the bell with the hat half full of water and survived the dive. They had the tank dug off of a railroad car, and they painted it up to look like a submarine. And they also used the wet bell as targets. They then used the constructor's scanning sonar to demonstrate their search and recovery capability. On their last attempt, they were unable to locate the wet bell, and that was a $10,000 loss. When they returned to Thunder Bay, the banks foreclosed and arrested the constructor. Deep diving systems and Interspace Biomarine dissolved their relationship. John Gerard and two of his divers all took the rebreathers and left town. Deep diving systems went bankrupt, and the constructor and Fred's rebreather were purchased by CanDive. A couple of years later, Interspace finally got a very lucrative contract on an oil rig in the North Sea. At a depth of 1,500 feet, the first diver locked out, but his rebreather failed and he died. His partner geared up and recovered his body and returned him to the diving bell, where he subsequently died as well. The PP1 system never did become popular with commercial divers. Gerry was still diving the Gwendolyn, slowly, methodically working his way forward on the ship. We were all still diving Isle Royale, and that's where things went horribly wrong. Don Curran was a close personal friend of mine and one of my principal diving partners. Mark Nardine arrived at the park with his own boat, his own dive gear, and his own compressor, and no dive partner. He joined Gerry in a number of dives and purchased one of Gerry's big lights. He also joined us for a couple of dives. It was a beautiful weekend in our version of the good life, and we were again off to the park diving. Don's days off did not coincide with everyone else's. He made his own transportation arrangements and joined us on a Saturday. We had a great dive and a barbecue afterwards. Slingshot water balloons and horseback wrestling were a popular pastime. I returned to Thunder Bay, and Don and Mark did two dives on the stern of the Kamloops. Their dive profiles, bottom times, and activities were very similar to what we had all been doing. I was at work the next day when the call came. Don had failed to surface after a dive. We notified his wife, Linda, and family. We were all devastated. Then I drove to Duluth and had a talk with Gerry. Don had only been diving for 3 years, and Mark was new to the sport as well. Perhaps they wanted to dive the bow before Gerry or myself, I don't know. But they put together a dive plan that ended in disaster. They were trying to swim a line from the stern of the ship to the bow. No one else in our group would have attempted this. Perhaps there were two or three dives that could have been done, but it was a huge workload for the diver. In error, they thought the depth of the bow on the spot where they were going to attach the line was 210 feet. It was, in reality, 230 feet deep. Don was wearing double 80s and Mark double 104s. Don dragged the line and Mark was pushing one of Jer's big lines. Don attached the line to the ship and then ran out of air as Mark had a free-flowing regulator. Mark then made a 230-foot free ascent and made it back to the boat and onto an O2 line and decompressed successfully. It was heartbreaking and depressing, but we decided to try and recover his body. Back in Thunder Bay, I stopped in to see the one guy who knew about diving accidents, Red Brunel. He had reorganized and his new company was FOB Marine. He had been able to hold onto or repurchase quite a bit of the equipment from DDS. Most of the boats, the chamber, and the IBAC camera system. The camera could be configured into diver held mode and used as a drop camera in that fashion. Fred loaned me the camera. He had paid $32,000 for it. When we returned to the island, we were joined by two divers from Lake Michigan, Paul Ehorn and Emmett Moneyhunt. Gerry and Bob made a dive in the stern and worked their way forward halfway up the ship with no results. Paul and Emmett made a dive in the bow and located Don's body in 255 feet of water. Then the weather turned on us and we were stuck at the dock for over a week. Finally, we had a chance for a dive. Bob and Jer were lighting and filming. I was also laying. Emmett and Paul were to attach a lift line. As he passed me at 230 feet, Emmett lost the lift line. He then picked up a scrap piece of line and tied it to Don's tanks in air, effectively tying him to the wreck. It was necessary to do another dive. Gerry filmed and I was on lights. Bob untied the line that Emmett had put on in error and secured a lift line. We recovered Don's body and had whatever degree of closure you can find at a funeral. But we were never the same after that. This is where Gerry received his first letter of commendation from the Department of the Interior, U.S. National Park Service. There were still a lot of good times and good diving ahead in the park. Gerry did eventually explore and film the Gwendolyn from stern to stem, and he needed a new project. It was in 1979 and 1980 that we first met Dan Lenihan, Larry Murphy, Tony Carroll, and Gerry Livingston, the National Park Service Submerged Cultural Resources Unit. They were doing an archaeological assessment of the park's submerged archaeological resources. This was focused around shipwreck sites. This was a 5-year study that took 6 years to complete. Gerry and I, along with the other Isle Royale regulars, were the local knowledge. I was invited to attend field school and found it fascinating. They were using a multidisciplinary approach. Pat Labadie and Tom Holden were the foremost authorities on maritime history in that part of the Great Lakes, and they both worked at the Canal Park Maritime Museum in Duluth. They contributed to the study. I soon recognized that a historical approach made a huge contribution to our understanding the archaeology of submerged shipwreck sites. The first site map they did was on the Monarch. It was quite a thing to see for the first time. I was looking at a representation of the major site components in one overview. It was the first time I saw the site that I was not limited by underwater visibility. Underwater photography and video were essential tools in the study. Everyone was diving the same equipment package, and we easily integrated into the team. It was a beautiful morning, and I woke up in my boat at Rock Harbor. I stepped out into the back deck with a cup of coffee, and Gerry had just finished gassing up his boat. The engine wouldn't start. I watched as he opened the engine box, and when he turned the key, a geyser of water 18 inches tall spurted up out of the carburetor. The timing chain had slipped 180 degrees. The exhaust valves were now intaking. Gerry made the 65-mile trip back to Grand Portage on his 9.5-horsepower trolling motor. They were overtaken by a storm and experienced St. Elmo's fire. One of his favorite mantras was, the ability to overcome adversity builds character. He was quite a character. The next year he was back with a new boat. His second name, the Madeline Goodrush, occasionally hailed as the RV Madeline Goodrush, a larger boat that served him well for many years. The United States Coast Guard cutter Woodrush had been stationed at Duluth. The Coast Guard did not think too much of the name similarity as they thought it led to confusion on the VHS radio, particularly after cocktail hour. It was not difficult, however, to distinguish the two vessels. The Goodrush was 36 feet long, and the Woodrush was 180 feet long. It was the Woodrush that was wrecked at Marquette. Gerry never lost a boat. I taught a basic scuba and field methodology course in Houghton for park rangers. When the Submerged Cultural Resource Unit was in the park, I worked with them. The rest of the time, we were on our own. Jer would load up with park ranger divers and check out sites from a master list that we had. If you are wondering what it was like, I can show you. Here I am swimming to the descent line on the Algoma in 1985. Rick O'Dale and Dave Bouchard are assisting with the lighting on this dive. This is a 162-foot dive. Today we would use mixed gas on a dive like this, but all we had then was air. So this is impaired diving and impaired archaeology. Divers use Martini's law to measure the degree of impairment they experience due to narcosis of depth. This is a 3.5 Martini dive. I toss the camera to Jer, and we are descending. We approach the photocline, the point where sunlight no longer penetrates the water column. One of the historical counts suggests that the Algoma broke in half and that the bow floated away. All of the bow wreckage we have been able to find is in small, badly broken pieces. We are tied off on a section of the bow mast. Close by, I am looking at a badly broken lifeboat. All that is left is the keel, the bow, and the stern stems. It's all now lying flat on the bottom. There is no sign of human remains, but the sole of a woman's shoe lies cradled in the remains of the lifeboat. One cannot help but feel that in the finest tradition of men, ships, and the sea, women and children were first into the lifeboats. Also close at hand is a case of gin. Saving the booze from a watery grave may be a lesser known Canadian maritime tradition. A half hour's work, then ascent and decompression. It was on the Algoma site that we started making documentaries with Stanley.
My name is Scott McWilliam. During the summer of 1985, I've been involved with a group of sport divers diving here at Isle Royale National Park, taking a look at some of the park's submerged cultural resources.
There were a lot of outtakes.
The mine operated here from 1855 to 1845. Or as we sometimes say, 1845 to 1855. Just over here. I think we should start over again and redo this right now. These outtakes are going to be hilarious.
I forgot!
We were able to put together enough material to approach WDSE, the PBS affiliate in Duluth, Minnesota, and produced a short documentary, Algoma Shipwreck. One day when it was too rough to dive on the Algoma site, we made one of our most interesting and significant finds. We were using diver propulsion vehicles to look for the remains of a sunken aircraft. Gerry and Bob had found the site some years before. I found the airframe, and my dive partner, Dave Bouchard, found what he described as a hand-turned pot. When we returned to videotape, we discovered the ceramic was prehistoric. After a series of dives, it was excavated. It radiocarbon dated to 1,000 years. Stylistically, it is Jutinen, a form named after a site in the Straits of Michilimackinac. It had made its way to Isle Royale by travel or trade. The Submerged Cultural Resources Unit attracted incredible talent and technology to their study. On the Kamloops site, due to the water depth, there was little more they could do by diving. However, National Geographic participated in the study and attended with two rove units. They tested their equipment on the Algoma site and then went to the Kamloops. It is a difficult site to work with that technology. The roves hung up occasionally. Our understanding of the Kamloops site was greatly increased, but the central question, what caused the Kamloops to go down, still remains a mystery. The Algoma site was to receive the attention of the Seward Johnson, then a one-year-old, 120-foot-long, Harbor Branch research vessel equipped with a four-man submarine. Their technology was very expensive and it took a lot of time to deploy. It was a four-day minimum to dive the sub on the Kamloops, and we only had one free day. We attended at the Algoma site and used their rove, which is equipped with a scanning sonar. Small trails of wreckage were followed down to a depth of 435 feet, with no sign of the bow or any larger structural components. Both Gerry and I did a lot of traveling back and forth to the park by float plane. That provided a different perspective of the lake. We often flew over shipwreck sites, and by looking at the shore, the wrecks, and the reefs from the air, the wreck events were easier to understand in a way that was more personal. In the same way that he had finished documenting the Gwendolyn and moved on, the Isle Royale study also came to an end. There were no more major shipwrecks to be found there. Gerry looked for other shipwrecks. He searched for the Benjamin Noble. He found the Mayflower, an 18th century sailing vessel. Everyone in the group went on to do their own research projects. Ryan spent years doing historical research and found a couple of dozen shipwrecks. He made substantial research contributions to the Lake Superior National Maritime Conservation Area. One of the other things we were all doing was assisting search and rescue and various law enforcement agencies from time to time with body recoveries. That's when we got the call and ended up heading back to the Gwendolyn. Gerry showed his film Helium at Our World Underwater and at Underwater Canada, and that is where we first met Reg Barrett, Fred Upton, and Jan Koulas. I had also shown a bit of film I had shot on the Gwendolyn at one of the workshops, and they introduced themselves. Reg was the group leader, and the first words out of his mouth when we spoke were that he was going to remove the bell from the Gwendolyn. I did not want to have anything to do with him if he was going to be removing artifacts. When I said so, he recanted and then said that he just wanted to dive the wreck. Reg was very British and had trained with the British sub-aquanauts, and before emigrating to Canada had swam the English Channel 3 times. I mentioned that the Kamloops was a good place to start. Ken Verana bumped into them on the Kamloops site the following summer. They had come around Blake Point from Rock Harbor to the Kamloops site in 2 14-foot aluminum boats. They were big risk takers. Fred had helped me in the past and we were all on good terms, so I took a recompression chamber course with two of his sons, and that is where I next met Reg and Fred. They had gone out to dive the Gwendolyn and dragged up a submerged descent line, the one that was on the bow mast. Jan and Fred were going to do a dive first, and Reg was going to do a solo dive when they returned. When they reached the deck at 255 feet, Jan saw skeletons with top hats on swimming around and aborted the dive. Fred said he did not experience any narcosis and toured the wreck. In error, he then came up the stern mast and found another yellow descent line. He decompressed the best he could, but as his decompression gas and oxygen were over on the other line, he became badly bent. When I met Fred, he was paralyzed from the waist down. I went for 3 chamber rides with him and got him walking again. I also talked with Reg, and to my amazement, Reg turned around and said that while I had to decompress like everyone else, due to their many years of training and experience, they were not affected by nitrogen narcosis or oxygen toxicity. Now you might think they might have taken the hint and dialed it back a bit, but that did not happen. They were totally committed to their method and out to prove that their method was superior. That winter they went out ice diving on Lake Simcoe. They used cave diving reels rather than conventional ice diving ropes, harnesses, and tenders. Jan signaled that he was getting cold and that he was heading back to the surface. Fred and Reg continued their dive for another 15 minutes. When they returned to the hole, they found Jan close to the hole, but floating under the ice, dead. They were soundly castigated at the coroner's inquest for abandoning conventional ice diving procedures. But they left the hearing convinced that they were right and that everyone else just did not understand. Reg and Fred returned to the Gwendolyn the following summer. They steered clear of Rossport and camped out on the beach, east of town. They dove the Gwendolyn on air with O2 decompression for 6 days. On the last few dives, they were removing artifacts, a teacup, a saucer, a couple of pairs of binoculars. Fred removed the small bell from the binnacle on the flying bridge, and over a couple of dives, Reg removed the larger bell from the bow and was moving it to the base of the bow mast when he died. If you run their dive profiles through a modern decompression program, it is apparent that their O2 clocks had maxed out. He may have had an O2 convulsion at depth. When we arrived, Dave Zarosky and I did a dive and searched the area from the stern mast to the flying bridge with no result. After that dive, Fred took our tanks to fill so we could dive the next day. I was using double 104s, and he made some kind of comment about the hydro and the burst discs on the tanks. The next day I was dressing, and there was a bang like a 22 caliber rifle shot. A burst disc in my tank valve had ruptured. It then came out that the tanks had been overfilled. They were taking their own tanks, steel, double 72s, and hydrostatically testing them annually, and then putting in 2 burst plugs and overfilling them to 3,500 PSI so that they had enough gas for the dive. They were too dangerous to get into the same boat with. The police attended and resources were brought in. A 65-foot Ministry of the Environment boat, a $43,000 Rove and operator from Candive, and a liaison from the Government of Ontario attended to coordinate interministerial activities in the effort to recover Mr. Barrett's body. Reg had worked for the Ministry of Corrections and at one time had been the warden of the Vanier Women's Prison. His dive partner had gotten mixed up with the wrong crowd as a kid and done time for armed robbery. People had questions about what had happened to Reg. In my view, the Rove did not have enough umbilical for the job. In short order, it was entangled in the stern mast stays. The Rove was hopelessly entangled. The topside end of the umbilical was tied off to a rubber inner tube. It was a somber crowd back at Rossport. Reg's wife had arrived, and so had his brother, who had come all the way from England. Constable Barton had been made coroner's constable, and his response was to call in a second, $80,000 Rove from Candive. This was something, but we did not have a lot of confidence in the Roves. We already had one hung up in the stern mast rigging, and we could easily lose the other. My dive partner, Dave Zarosky, had seen enough and headed back to Thunder Bay. Dave had worked in the North Sea and in Ontario as a commercial diver. as he saw it, to continue would require a mini-sat system, support vessels, diving medicals, etc. It would take weeks to put together. I did not have anything particularly positive or optimistic to add. Besides, wait and see. We could possibly come back after the police had finished their investigation and try again. This did not go over well with Reg's family and friends. The next day, the plan was to put the newly arrived Rove onto the 65-foot Ministry of the Environment boat and have a look with that. Ryan, Gerry, Shirley, and I went out ahead of the ministry boat to pull up Fred's mooring lines to accommodate the larger boat. Ryan and I were getting into our suits as we approached the site. Ryan turned and asked what the two white things were that were floating over by the inner tube. I gave it a quick glance and said it was just a couple of seagulls. As we came closer, it was Reg's white diving fins that we were looking at. Reg was lying on his back with his suit partly inflated, with the Rove umbilical tied around his waist. Fred had gone out at 2 o'clock in the morning and made a dive. He found Reg and recovered his body. He brought him to the surface, holding on to his wrists. He had decompressed that way, face to face, for an hour and a half. Now, the police had been quite specific about not wanting any unauthorized diving being done. So I popped in and attached a line to Reg so we would not lose him if the inner tube failed. And then we sat back and waited for the police to arrive. When the police did get there, they tore into Ryan and I because they thought we had gone diving and recovered Reg. We had to explain how we found him, and then we subsequently recovered his body. As you might expect, back at the dock in Rossport, Fred got quite a talking to. But as his nocturnal diving activities had not attracted any attention, and no one could prove it was him, Reg's return to the surface was attributed to mysterious currents. Everyone went home except Fred Upton. He continued diving and recovered the Rove unit. Fred Burnell was not all that happy. As he saw it, Fred Upton had several runs in his recompression chamber and then come back to remove artifacts from his shipwreck. In the finest tradition of pirates, they decided to split up the loot. Fred Upton gave Fred Burnell the small bell he had removed from the flying bridge. Mr. Burnell then had the ship's name engraved on it and sold it to a collector for $5,000. Reg's wife received the teacup and saucer and a pair of the binoculars, and Ned Basher at the Rossport Inn received the other pair of binoculars and a gauge. Fred Upton returned to the Gwendolyn and did extensive deep solo air dives on the wreck for several years. He found the bell Reg had been removing and returned it to the bow and reinstalled it with the original bronze bolts. He also installed two brass commemorative plaques with the names of his two lost diving partners on the wreck. And, as per Reg's request, he then placed Reg's ashes on the Gwendolyn site, a circuitous last trip for Reg. I do not think Gerry or Ryan or I had any plans to return to the Gwendolyn after Reg's recovery, but Gwendolyn has a way of calling you back. Fred divorced for a third time, but his bad luck continued, and FOB Marine also failed. He was later able to reorganize under Cabro Marine, and they did well for a time. They did a lot of work with the tug and the dump scow around the harbor. Cabro Marine also was able to put together a reasonably sophisticated Gwendolyn mission. Fred acquired good videotape that had been shot by diver Bill Gardner, and they then rented a Rove unit and headed out for Gwendolyn. The Rove unit was hung up in short order, and it took a long time to entangle a unit. Fred was still armed with Bill's videotape, and he went on television on the Rick Smith show. It was kind of sad in a way.
Now all I need is a few rubles and up she comes. And when she comes up, everybody sees her gonna fall in love with her. That's how beautiful she is. You know, I can't describe it, because if you're not a diver and you just look at a few video shots, that's not the same. You got to see her sitting beside the cliff, just as if she decided to moor herself for a few years.
When we iron, we have to dip the iron and bring her up, wipe her clean, and dip the pure iron.
Yes.
A chamber is decompressed the divers, but also a chamber is the fountain of youth, and it's also, I can go on and on, but it's also hyperbaric medicine, like for MS patients, if you have somebody has the Parkinson's disease, you can help them for a limited time. If you put somebody in who is bald, for instance, and give him enough treatments, you get his hair back, you know, like...
Oh, come on.
it's called the hyperbaric medicine, and it's the fountain of youth. And why do you think Michael Jackson has one of his own?
Fred's understanding of the Gwendolyn was seen as delusional, and Cabro Marine also subsequently failed. Then everything changed again. Ryan had met Sheck Exley at Patty College, and I spoke to him on several occasions on the phone. I acquired a copy of Dr. X's decompression program, also a copy of DCOM. Now, by using computers, it was possible to plan complex trimix dives using helium that eliminated the problem of nitrogen narcosis. Also, by decompressing on nitrox and oxygen, the diver could decompress efficiently. When Peter Gimbel was making a 25-minute dive in the Andrea Doria, they were decompressing both in the water and on the surface in the chamber for 5 hours. Now the dive is done in less than half the time. In a way, with technical diving, deep just became 100 feet deeper. I made arrangements with Fred for his material and with Gerry, and I studied their material, I applied for an archaeological license, and I studied the site. Things worked out surprisingly well. Free from nitrogen narcosis, it was possible to see everything Gerry had seen and do it in 3 or 4 dives rather than 30 or 40. Looking back, you look at the huge effort that had been put in, the loss of life, it all seemed unnecessary and pointless with the event of mixed gas diving. By the end of the study, it was apparent that there was more than just archaeology, more than anthropology at play. The Gwendolyn is a beautiful story. For a year, I shopped it around as a possible book. When Gerry was diving the Gwendolyn, Bob and I had worked on a film, Coming Back Alive, with the National Film Board of Canada. We had always dreamed of making a movie. Perhaps Gwendolyn was calling us back for a picture. I approached the National Film Board of Canada, and it took over a year to put it together. But we were able to attract a very talented director, Tim Southam, and we made the film, Drowning in Dreams. This was a great opportunity. The film had a $500,000 budget, and Tim was able to put together a very talented crew of filmmakers. Today we use video cinema cameras, but at that time we used film cameras. The principal camera was an Eaton, a Super 16mm camera. The new underwater shots we did were done on an Aeroflex 3 35mm camera. Most of the underwater footage on the Gwendolyn is Gerry's Super 8 film that's been blown up straight to 35mm. Filming this way, we used a sound engineer with a Nagra tape recorder and a boom microphone and lapel microphones to record the soundtrack. Drowning in Dreams is an award-winning film, but it's Tim's film. In the end, all of the participants were quite comfortable with the final product, but we might have taxed Tim's patience, as it can be hard to make a film with 5 directors. Over the years, Gerry and I became close personal friends. When I married, he was my best man. We would visit when we traveled to the United States, and for many years we attended Gerry's 4th of July party. Gerry's Pike Lake residence had a large yard that was always well appointed with children and large Newfoundland dogs. The Buchanans had a number of interesting family customs.
Hey, Scott, come on!
Yeah?
The yard was also equipped with several quad runners, jet skis, boats, and a pool. As a personal philosophy, he would often joke that the guy who dies with the most toys wins. Similarly, he owned a number of muscle cars over the years. Firebirds with big block engines, that type of vehicle. He was known to vote Republican. To find out what he was going to be up to next, he always wanted to take in the tour of his garage. He was ingenious and always thinking of underwater research.
And the sea otter is on a 500-foot umbilical now?
Yes.
And you're doing special things with...
modulators?
More camera and a modulator.
We'll put two modulators in, three videos in, one coax out.
And what's the camera array going to be like?
Types of cameras. This is a standard fish cam, good for 500 feet. That will plug in to a plug like this.
Now, are they going to be externally mounted or internally?
Yes, externally.
I see.
Little arm, put them where you want. This is an infrared camera with a circle of LEDs.
Ooh, that's very nice. And what's the advantage of infrared?
We're not sure. This may be a mistake. It may be an experiment that doesn't work.
Okay, so how many cameras will you have on board the Rove unit when you're all done?
We'll have six.
Six cameras on board the Rove unit.
Main cameras out the front.
Main cameras out the front.
And then there's going to be one little teeny camera, like those little spy cams, that's going to look through the dome in the back.
I see.
For our rearward facing.
Now, the only one who was there for all of Gerry's adventures was Gerry. We had started out as young men diving together, but the years passed. Bob completed his PhD in geophysics and went to work for the USGS, so he wasn't around as much, but occasionally they could get together for a project.
Gold in them, and maybe half a gram, but it's better than no gold. You know what it looks like? It's nice. Pretty cool.
Well, according to historical legend, Theano, which is the shipwreck out at, I think it's Trowbridge, she was the wife of Pythagoras, of the Pythagorean theorem. And when he died, she took over his mathematical theories, and she developed some sort of mathematics that is still used today.
We enjoyed each other's company and worked on projects like the Theano together. Gerry thought finding the Theano was a long shot, but it was an intriguing sight and worth having a look for. The Theano came to a very dramatic end. November 17th, 1906, she ran into a series of reefs and islands near Trowbridge Island in a snowstorm. The crew successfully abandoned ship. Captain Peterson rigged a sail in the lifeboat he was in command of and made his way back to Port Arthur. There, he enlisted the services of the tug James Whalen and recovered the crew of the second lifeboat, who had made their way to Hare Island. The James Whalen also found an oil slick and the Theano in 360 feet of water. Larry Race, Gerry Eliason, and Craig Smith had also done some looking for the Theano a few years earlier. They did a lot of work with a proton magnetometer, and they found the Theano's propeller off the east end of Marvin Island. And how far could a ship go without a propeller? Rick O'Dale also had an interesting spot. He had a good quality video sonar unit and thought he had found the wreck in 180 feet of water and gave us the location. It would require specialized equipment to look. Ken Engelbert was part of the group, and we were all good friends, and he had specialized equipment. He built his own. When Ken was not out diving, he was a senior electrical engineer and CPU architect for mainframe computers at Unisys. On some projects, Ken had 40 engineers working for him. Ken built a drop camera with its own lighting system that was operational to 1,000 feet. Ken had built his own side-scan sonar. This included cutting his own transducer crystals and writing his own Windows-based software to interpret the signal. I had an archaeological license, Gerry bought the Rove, and we headed out for a look. We did some diving and re-examined the ship's propeller. We also did a mixed gas dive at this location, down to 205 feet, with no results. A local commercial fisherman and diver, Jim Dyson, had found parts of the bow stem and shallow water off the east end of Trowbridge Island. This matched up with the historical account, so we dove there and found sections of the bow stem and wreckage. The Theano chewed her nose off on the rocks there. We also did a mixed gas dive north of this wreckage and found the stern anchor in 175 feet of water.
It's the stern steering anchor. Or the auxiliary.
If it is, then there's a good chance she was going over as she went by.
Well, I'm telling you to go down there and find an anchor after all this talk. It was just too funny.
It was.
We had one boat set up for diving in case it was necessary to recover the Rove or the side scan sonar fish. We headed out to Trowbridge Island and went to work. We spent hours with the side-scan sonar, only to discover that Rick's lead did not work out. He had discovered a submerged escarpment. Later, Gerry was to be very philosophical about it.
Especially in these areas, in here, not up close, but out in here, it's going to stick out like a sore thumb. So.
That's a damn good theory, because that's a nice shallow reef. I'll get stuck on that. Stern swings around, slams against this hill, prop rolls down here. Stern starts to sink, slides that way, and the whole ship slides backwards over there.
Well,
and Gerry and Ken can't pick it up.
some people say, well, God invented alcohol, you know.
Well, water into wine, not peach juice.
The Silver Islet area is a fascinating place, but it's very difficult to do any underwater archaeology there due to extensive site degradation. The historic town site and docks were built on an existing prehistoric site, and that pretty much obliterated it. The clear waters off the dock attracted some of the region's first sport divers, who systematically mined kaolin pipes and old bottles from the bottom for decades. The submerged archaeological record at the Silver Islet mine site was destroyed by professionals. According to legend, the site was worked prehistorically. The exposed face of the vein is heavily pockmarked and has been worked down to a depth of 6 feet. Prior to the establishment of the Silver Islet mine, Silver Islet was known as Skull Rock. The Silver Islet mine was the richest silver mine in the world for a time. To accommodate the mining operation, the original islet was expanded out to 5.5 acres through an extensive series of cribbings. Mining operations came to an end when a shipment of coal did not arrive in time for winter. The steam pumps eventually ran out of fuel and the mine flooded. The lake has been reducing the islet since the mine closed. While you might expect a lot of deposition in the surrounding waters, that is not the case. When the mine was running, they used low-grade ore from the mine to fill the cribbings. There are numerous intact and broken cribbings in the area, but the bottom between the cribbings is sterile. This is a direct effect of the 1979-1980 attempt to corner the world silver market by Nelson, Lamar, and William Hunt. The price of silver jumped from $6.08 an ounce to $49.45 an ounce. QC expeditions did some testing and decided that the low-grade ore could now be mined at a profit. Thunder Bay Marine contractor Elliot Dawson was hired, and they dredged up several hundred tons of rock. Everything in between the cribbings was removed, totally obliterating the archaeological record. This material was transported back to Thunder Bay, piled up on a wharf, and waited to be run through a crusher. The Hunt brothers failed to corner the silver market, and the price of silver collapsed. It was no longer economical to run the ore through the crusher. After a number of years, it was loaded back onto the barge, taken out onto the lake, and dumped into Thunder Bay. There is a large, sterile, submerged site. Two of the mine shaft entrances are below water level. Dave Zaroski and Marcel Tardif assisted with the diving, photography, and videotaping when we checked out the area. Gerry had a look with the rove, which did not do any better than divers in the mine shaft. One of the questions that remained unanswered regarded the deep water area south of the islet. We wondered if cultural deposition had been washed down the hill. Gerry was able to use the rove down to a depth of 435 feet. He found the bottom to be sterile. We looked at a number of these island mines, and I wrote a small book on the subject. The years passed, the diving continued. We all went on with our lives, our families, and our careers. Bob went on to become the director of research for the USGS. I was doing a lot of diving in Lake Erie near Long Point. Gerry found a great new dive spot, the Caribbean Sea. His next boat was a 48-foot sailboat, which he kept at Fort Pierce in Florida. We had a visit with Gerry and Anna there, and it was a glimpse into a very different part of his life and a very different kind of life. A world of expensive fishing boats and yachts. The marina is next to the Manatee Museum. Dolphins and manatees swam around the boat every day. It was a great place to relax. You could spend your time building crab traps for the kids. Then again, there is the call of the sea. Out on the ocean, sailing a big sailboat like that can be very exhilarating. This was quite the life for aging divers, and Gerry had his boat there for many years. The downside to Florida was the hurricane season. It was nerve-wracking. Even with the boat, onshore, secured, and well insured, it was always possible to lose the boat due to a weather event. We stopped in at Harbor Branch. There was the Seward Johnson at the dock. After decades of service, she was now in for her first refit. Time passed and Gerry eventually sold the Madeline Rose and purchased a beautiful home in Hawaii and a 26-foot sea rig. He continued to dive, usually with his kids. Shortly after he moved his offshore camp to Hawaii, a hurricane destroyed the marina at Fort Pierce in Florida. During the reconstruction, a $178,000 treasure was recovered from the bottom. It is believed to be from the 1715 Spanish treasure fleet. We should have done more diving while we were there. Gerry's life continued this way for many years. He traveled back and forth between Hawaii and Minnesota. Then he lost a filling. He went to the dentist and came home with an appointment to a specialist the following morning. He was diagnosed with cancer. The cancer was relentless, but Gerry was in the fight for 4 years. There was surgery, chemotherapy, and what seemed like an endless series of drugs and trials. Gerry even had hyperbaric treatments. The cancer would diminish or go into remission, only to resurface in a few weeks or months. As the end of life drew near, Gerry's friends traveled from all over the United States and Canada to have that last visit. I resisted. Some of the best memories when I was the happiest of my life were when I was diving and hanging out with Gerry, and I was afraid seeing him so ill would in some way preempt or overwrite the good memories. This turned out not to be the case. I made the 1,700 kilometer drive across the top of Lake Superior in February to see him. The cancer had robbed him of his voice and he had lost 100 pounds, but he was still Gerry and it was good to be there. Gerry's brother Peter made the guest room available and my 2-day visit stretched into 5. I would visit for hours every day and look at pictures of our kids in the computer and talk about our lives and our diving adventures. I had driven a rental down from Thunder Bay, and when the time came to head home, Gerry wrote me a note. All it said was, "Stay with me." I stayed a little longer and had a visit the following morning. The parting that served us well was just, "I'll see you at the 4th of July party, Ger." Even then, the glass still remained half full. I had a long drive along the frozen north shore of Lake Superior. A friend, Nate Fanning, had a symphony engagement in Thunder Bay, but had a few days off in between performances and offered to be my camera assistant. One of the first places we headed out to shoot was back to Silver Island. Lake Superior is beautiful and timeless. You can do a lot of thinking there. Our diving and shipwreck studies advanced our understanding of the Great Lakes maritime Midwest and its cultural ethos. In the least, Gerry's brand of study is clearly advocational anthropology. In terms of cultural resource management, early efforts on film and video are invaluable as a datum to measure site degradation. Terrestrial archaeologists are often faced with the problem of seemingly endless collections, all in need of analysis. In the same way, maritime archaeologists need to recognize the value of early on-site imaging. Perhaps in the future, funding will be found to have early collections digitized for public access and research and cultural resource management at places like Isle Royale. Gerry's well-lived life ended a few weeks later, and we attended the funeral. Gerry gave everyone jobs or titles on the boat. Ken, or Bob, would usually be the science officer. Ryan was often the historian. If you were new to the boat, or a kid, you were a swab. You could, however, work your way up to cable guy and end up managing Rove Umbilico. He always called me the chronicler. My job was to record and tell the tale. I hope you like the effort.